Welcome, fight fans. 203 Fight Network here. Today, we're going to talk and finish my UFC Fight Night 108 preview and predictions. We also have some news on Jon Jones and Daniel Cormier. Will that fight happen in UFC 214 in the end of July? Stay tuned after this. Good morning, everyone. Mark G here. It is Saturday, April 22nd, 2017. Just had to make sure that I was right. It's been a long, long night, long morning, but we're here. This is the 203 Fight Network, right now exclusively on YouTube.com. Thanks for tuning in to the Objective Perspective. Episode 4, Part 2. We're going to finish up my some of the six or so fights that I didn't get to. You know, we want to keep everything fair to all the fighters. They all train very hard. You know, but, you know, before we get into fights, we're just going to, you know, they did have the weigh-ins last night. I'm going to talk a little bit about that quickly. He did have a fighter miss weight. I'm going to give you my opinion and perspective on that matter, what they should possibly start doing for these, you know, sometimes these guys, they miss weight by, you know, 4, 5, 6 pounds. I mean, a couple months, maybe it was a good about 6 or 7 months ago now, they had a cowboy, Alex Oliveira, who a fighter out of Brazil, who was fighting at lightweight, but probably should have always been fighting at welterweight, because he came in a good, he came in so much over 8, 10, 12 pounds. It was insane how much he was over, and he was fighting the former Bellator champ, Will Brooks, and, you know, the size disadvantage there and the size difference was just immensely, it just stood out. So this time here, Rogério de Lima missed weight. He weighed in at 210 for the 205-pound limit. And they actually fined him 30% of his purse. It's the second time in a row he's missed weight. I really think they need to start doing a little more. Starts either, you know, suspending, you know, to the matter of, you know, not even having the fight, you know, to where, you know, basically the whole show money will go to, you know, to the opponent, assuming he makes weight. You're contracted to make weight, you know, like it's in there, you know, that's why the weight's there. If you're not going to go for these weights and you're going to try and cheat the system little by little, you know, that's everybody's always trying to gain an edge. So people, everybody gets on everyone for steroids or their quote unquote PEDs, as they so like to call it, you know, that nice media term that's been made up, you know, performance enhancing drugs. You know, that there's a fighter out there, he said it best, performance enhancing, and why would I take something that wasn't going to help me? What am I going to take something that's going to hurt me? You know, but I guess it's whatever they deem legal at the time or not. But there's so many other ways in any sport, and that these guys are always trying to gain an advantage. It's kind of comical to think that they're not going to, you know, they got these guys doing that with trying to gain weight in the weigh-ins, and they're really trying to gain an advantage over their opponent absolutely from the start, considering, you know, they're cutting weight and not even fighting. You know, 85% of these fighters don't fight at their natural weight class, and it seems like the small percentage of ones that do actually have more healthier performances, you know, in the long run. So, you know, they really should start to think about, you know, heavier fines for these missed weights if they're really getting on the fact that they're trying to, protect these fighters and protect them from these vicious weight cuts and but you know it all starts you really have to break down the fundamentals there and kind of really, you know, what are they doing? They're sucking themselves dry all the time, and then they're fighting, you know, but you are letting these guys come in overweight, miss weight, and then still fight. So how are you actually protecting them? That's basically my whole point. Might have taken a little while to get there, but trying to start with a little bit of an opening today for part two. Hoping y'all enjoyed part one. If you didn't, please check that out. It is live on YouTube along with parts 1, 2, and 3, as well as my reviews of the Tough The Ultimate Fighter 25 Redemption, which has two former winners, Joe Stevenson and Eddie the Truck Gordon. Tough season 2 for Joe Stevenson. Yeah, that was a long time ago, about 10, 11, 12 years maybe. And then Eddie Gordon from Tough 16 or Tough 22, I believe. I'm sorry, I can't really recall at the moment, and I'm not about to turn the pages to my notes there to find out. But it is definitely a pretty interesting season, and all these former fighters going for redemption, trying to win $250,000. They're actually getting paid to fight here, so these are actually professional fights. They're going to count on their record. And, you know, it's if you like watching some fights and you want to catch some quick fights, you tune in. It's on FS1 on Wednesday nights. And Cody Garbrandt and TJ Dillashaw are the coaches. They don't like each other. Cody Garbrandt already tried to choke literally with his hand. He probably went at him, snapped at him like a cobra, for Christ's sake. You know, it's pretty crazy. But I haven't watched Tough in a while. Got a little stale. Even that Tough 24 Champions Tournament of Champions they just had, where they took all the champions at the featherweight division, 125-pound division, from around the world, flew them in, put them in a house, put them in the Tough, the Ultimate Fighter format, and the winner got to fight Demetrius Johnson for the flyweight title. And Tim Elliott actually won that and took Demetrius 5 rounds, had Demetrius in trouble for about 90 seconds of that 25 minutes, and it really wasn't even too much trouble for Demetrius. As you know, he is pound for pound the best fighter in the world. He's also pound for pound the most unsung, the most, you know, he's underlooked, undervalued, underappreciated. If I can't get any more unders, you know, he is definitely there. You know, people don't watch him. I don't know if it's because of his attitude, blasé, or what, but you know, Demetrius is when you're watching him, it's if you appreciate and you enjoy MMA, you should enjoy him. I mean, you know, he just basically submitted a guy this past Saturday here. He submitted a guy that's never been submitted, who's a Brazilian jiu-jitsu black belt, a Brazilian who's been, you know, in the top 5 world champ. I mean, he's, you know, Wilson Hayes is, you know, a world-class grappler, world-class Brazilian jiu-jitsu, you know, expert. And Mighty Mouse armbarred him. Sorry. Demetrius armbarred him in the 3rd round. You know, and he's really doesn't even have a belt in that discipline. Obviously, he is fantastic in it, but when it comes to that ranking level, he doesn't have one. And that's the kind of level and the special type athlete that you're dealing with. He's in phenomenal shape that he comes in. It's just a pleasure to watch him, and I hope he kind of stays at 125, and I hope he shatters that record, because he tied it. He tied Anderson Silva's record. Anderson Silva Probably one of the greatest of all time. One of the scariest, Mr. Anderson, as we see him kicking Vitor in the face right there and on the shirt. But, get back to Demetrius real quick, and you can't really talk enough about him. Never gets into trouble. He's just top notch all around. But some news. There's been a lot of news going on in MMA. A lot of talk about weight classes and adding weight classes and changing of different things. And, I wouldn't mind seeing them add some weight classes. I think I'm going to look a little more into it so I can talk a little better about it. And maybe try and find some actual articles about it and see what they say. And we'll put that out there. Probably put that out, sometime middle of next week for partly in one of the next episodes here, the objective perspective. If I haven't said this before, if you haven't caught on any of my other podcast videos that are here on youtube.com, please check them out. Please subscribe to the channel, hit that thumbs up. Do you know it turns blue when you hit it? It's pretty amazing. Try it. Just hit it. It turns blue. It's fantastic. Fantastic. But we here at the 203 Fight Network would really appreciate the comment. Let us know how we're doing as well. But to get back to some of the news that was happening, Daniel Cormier and John Jones were actually, they didn't say verbally agreed. I guess Dana White verbally agreed for him, and he's trying to make that fight for UFC 214 in Anaheim. That'll probably be the co-main event of that fight. If this actually happens, it would be a pretty good card, considering you'd get Cyborg against Jermaine Durandamy, probably for the women's featherweight title, which would be a pretty great fight and pretty cool thing to see Cyborg finally, obtain, the dream that she's been working so hard for, unless she did have some setbacks with some, drug test failures and whatnot. But speaking of drug test failures, the Chael Sonnen and Wanderlei Silva are slated to fight in June at Madison Square Garden, MSG, in New York City. 90 miles up the turnpike there. But, don't get your hopes up for this Bellator pay-per-view that's happening, because I'm sure that pay-per-view will happen because they're putting way too much money in for it not to. But, and I feel really bad because I'm a big Chael Sonnen fan, but I don't see that fight happening. Wanderlei Silva will not be fighting. He will not be fighting. You heard it here first. I'm going to say it every time. He will not be fighting. I can't see it happening with all the problems we've had with the New York Commission. Wanderlei Silva hasn't fought in 5 years. He ran out on a drug test. Just so many possible things. We'll see if it happens. I hope I'm wrong for Chael's sake. I want to see Chael actually fight him, in a cage or, in a controlled environment and not having to basically defend himself against Wanderlei and a couple of Wanderlei's friends, or Wanderlei basically, sucker shotting him or, any things of that nature. And if you don't know what I'm talking about, then you have to go on the UFC Fight Pass and check out one of the Tough Brazils, and you'll see what I'm talking about. So we're going to have to get into now. Let's get into the Music City Showdown preview, UFC 108 Fight Night Live on FS1. The prelims are on FS2 and UFC Fight Pass, and let me tell you, this is a pretty underappreciated card. That's going to be the tone for the show. I guess it's going to be under. Okay, maybe we'll go with some underdogs. But during this preview show here, I'm going to finish this out. Some of the fights that we missed were basically a couple of the ones that you'll see on Fox Sports 2, as well as the fights, I'm sorry, that you're going to see on UFC Fight Pass. So to start it out, we're going to go from the basically from the ground up, and from the ground up, and from the opening fight. So, the opening fight on the UFC Fight Pass prelims would be Hector Sandoval versus Matt Schnall, who was a tough 24 contestant, actually lost in the quarterfinals to Tim Elliott. And he's a record of 10-3. His only real quote-unquote fight, or his actual second fight in the UFC, was to Rob Font, which he lost by TKO not that long ago, actually. So he's coming back pretty fast from this TKO loss. Did lose on the show. Had so basically it's almost essentially it's like he's lost two in a row. I don't see him, you know, this is a tough fight. I think it's a tough fight to come back from after 4 or 5 months. It's tough to come back from a TKO. You know, he's definitely a good fighter. He's a former legacy champ, from what I believe. If I'm wrong, you can call me a jamoke or a goon or, you know, an idiot or whatever in the comments. But just leave a comment in there, you know. It actually works if you type it in, you know. Just try to make some actual words that aren't profane. And, you know, we can have an actual intelligent conversation. You know, let me know what you think. His opponent, Hector Sandoval, I believe Team Alpha Male. Yeah, Team Alpha Male product. He's actually 1-1 in the UFC. I see him doing pretty well in this fight, actually. You know, he's got good coaches, and they're going to have definitely a good strategy, you know, to boot against this kid here. So, as long as he follows the game plan and listens to his coaches, I think he should do well. But, you know, Schnulls, I don't even know if I'm saying his name right. If I'm really hacking it up, you guys know what to do. Comment down there. Call me a name. I don't really care. But Sandoval's not a very big guy. He's only 5'2". He kind of makes me look like a giant, you know. So I'm already automatically liking this kid. But he's, like I said, Team Alpha Male product. He 1-1 in the UFC, has a victory his last fight over Freddy Soriano, Serrano, and that was on the Paige VanZant Waterson card. So the kid's been fighting, and he didn't lose his last fight. He won it, and he unanimous decision. So it looks like he pretty much dominated it. I don't remember it offhand. I probably didn't catch it if it was on the Fight Pass. Being that, you know, I didn't really have the Fight Pass before, but you know, he's got some fights here, and he's got a lot of grind out victories. So I'm gonna assume, I think this kid might even be one of those Brazilian jiu-jitsu experts over there at the Team Alpha Male with all those guys. You know, those guys will tear you apart, so don't go in there thinking that you're gonna, you know, jump all over them, because they'll take your back and choke you out. That's Team Alpha Male. The next fight on the Fight Pass prelims is actually a pretty good one at the 170-pound division. Joe Proctor, if you remember Joe Proctor from Tough Live, moving up to 170. I'm not sure if this is his first fight, second fight at 170 in his career, but I do know he has a 4-3 record, and he has not fought in a very long time. Excuse me, about 16 months. And he's coming off a loss to Magomed Mustafiev. I even practiced that name, and I got that wrong. Can you believe that? You know, I even practiced it. Sorry about that, folks. A little technical difficulty there. Didn't mean to hit the opening button. That was a total mistake. You know, I got to make at least one or two of those during a video. If you know me, then you understand. If you don't know me, you will understand. That's how that works. Joe Proctor versus Brian Barberina, the man that beat Sage Northcutt. Wow. Must have to learn how to speak, I guess. Sage, Sage. So, Sage Northcutt fought Brian Barberino a little while back. Brian Barberino called him out. Boom, right camera, that's right. You know, but he has since lost and hasn't been able. He was on a two-fight winning streak, won that fight. Brian Barberino, after he beat Sage, won a second fight, and then lost his last fight there in 2016. So we'll see how he starts 2017. This is supposed to be... this is his first fight. Joe Proctor, man, looked like he gained. He's really beefed up. I never seen him so big. He's really beefed up. So, and he has to be. And you know, Barberino, him, they were mean mugging during the weigh-in, stare downs, and trying to make it interesting. So it's, you know, it's good for them. Let's see if Barberino can put some consistency together. You know, I was a little skeptical on Proctor going in, but you know, he didn't really look too bad at the weigh-in. So yeah, and that was, I'm sorry, just to get back to the fight before with Schnell, and yeah, the other, he had a, see, there's number two Bal. The other, he had a rough weigh-in. There's a couple guys that are rough, had a rough weigh-in, so it's tough to really, you know, pick them. I tend to kind of go against those guys that have those rough weigh-ins. Sometimes it comes back to haunt me, like last week or a couple weeks back with Daniel Cormier and Rumble Johnson. So we'll see if it comes to back to haunt me there with that pick. But it's not like, you know, we're putting any money on it. You know how I feel about that. But I'm definitely going to still go with Barberino on this. I like his camp. You know, he's been more active. So... being more active, he's definitely kind of still been in the flow, even though he lost his last fight. I think he's going to be hungry to kind of try to put another win and get a win streak going. If he wins this fight, you know, it'll be 3 out of 4, and it won't really look as bad. So if he loses, then it's 2 in a row, and see how that goes. You know, he's the type of fighter, if you look where he's fighting on this card, he loses, man, he can get cut. And, you know, maybe he'll get signed. Obviously, he'll get signed by someone else, but I'm saying maybe he'll get signed by Bellator, maybe he won't. You know, I mean, obviously, that's the next, you know, best thing is to get signed by Bellator. But, you know, that doesn't always happen. And plus, if you're coming off a loss and you're coming off being cut, how really, you know, you want to get there when you got your value at the highest, man. And that's when you got to find out when your window is there, your window of opportunity, you know. So, either one of these guys, neither one of these guys want to lose this fight, man. You know, you're fighting this low on the card, especially this card. No offense, man. I love this card. I'm a big fan of Cub Swanson. You know, like I said in yesterday's part one, he he's skilled. He's got all the skills everywhere. You know, and he's tough as nails. He throws hard. He punches hard, man. He can take a punch. He'll choke you out. He knows how to defend. His only losses are to the top guys, man. And even a couple of those losses, he'll definitely, he's like to Ricardo Lamas and whatnot. And maybe even the, you know, Chad Mendez, he might be able to avenge a couple of those losses. Now, who knows, you know, you see on... He's got a small window where I think he's peaking out, and then when he loses that window, man, it's going to be tough, because that's how it is for fighters. When the window closes, it's just like everything goes, a la Chuck Liddell, you know? And it's sad. You don't want to see that happen. But the next fight is Cindy Dandois against Alexis Davis, the 135-pound women's division, the women's bantamweights. Alexis Davis, who has... fought for the title at one point, fought Ronda Rousey, was knocked out, TKO'd, I believe. Yeah, you know, pretty quick. She was one of those victims of Rousey. But she's come back and won some fights and then took some time off to become a mother, you know, good for her. And now she's back. I do believe that she lost her last fight. Yes, that's right. She fought Sarah McMahon. And she did lose her last fight, and that was at the Tough 24 finale back in December. And she actually lost by triangle choke, which I totally forgot that Sarah McMahon finished her. But she did have a win over Sarah Kaufman before that. You know, it's just been alternating and out, man. She's got wins over Liz Carmouche, Jessica Ai. So Alexis Davis is always prime. She's always ready to go. She can beat just about anybody and maybe lose just about anybody, too. That seems like sometimes how this women division goes. So there's, you know, so a lot of them are very skilled. There's a lot of skilled women, especially at 135. It's grown a lot, and it's grown very fast. And, you know, no matter if you like Ronda Rousey or you dislike Ronda Rousey, you have to give Ronda Rousey credit. And, you know, obviously, Amisha Tate and, you know, Cyborg, Chris Cyborg, you know, and Chris Justino. So it's a great division. I do not know too much about Cindy. We're going to find out. She did look really good at the weigh-ins, and that's not talking about anything of a sexual nature. I'm saying she looked good. She didn't look drawn out. She looked like she cut weight pretty well, pretty much used to, you know, that cut. Everything looked pretty comfortable for her. This is her UFC debut. I do know that. She's been fighting, obviously, over in Europe, being from Denmark. She seems like she finishes everybody she fights or gets finished. So her two losses are one by KO and one by submission, and she has mostly submissions and KOs in her finishes. So she's a little younger than Alexis, obviously, a little less experience there. Alexis Davis has been around a long time. They're actually the same age. I thought they were a little different, but they're actually the same age, 32. That's not bad. Not bad at all. But this is going to be an exciting fight, man. I'm going to tell you, the last couple Fight Pass prelims were awesome. And it's definitely, I mean, just if you're going to be around to catch those fights alone, sometimes they're really worth it. And even when they throw some of these cards on, unfortunately, some of these European cards that they do on Fight Pass aren't the greatest of cards in a whole. Is an entire card, but the main event and co-mains usually, you know, could be worth that price right there, you know. So, you know, if you're a fan, then check it out, because it's definitely worth it, you know. And it's always good to get in there. But I'm gonna go with Cindy in this fight. Who knows sometimes where some fighters' heads are at after they come back from a long layoff. And I think she's going to come out, as long as it depends on those jitters, man. She can either have a huge adrenaline dump, or she can come out and, you know, those and overcome any of those jitters and use that adrenaline to her and control it and use it to her advantage. Because there's going to be a big one there. You know, your first fight there in the UFC, no matter what, if it's on the main card, if it's on the prelims, no matter where it is, it's going to be something. So good luck to her. And, you know, we're going to get to the next women's fight here on the card, and that's an 115-pound strawweight division. Real exciting division. Jessica Penne against Danielle Taylor. And this fight, if you see the weigh-ins, this is definitely going to be an interesting fight. Danielle Taylor was another one who just looked really good. Like, she took the weight cut really well and handled it just phenomenally. Sometimes, you know, when you're cutting weight, you look super drawn out, and you can tell just how skinny and you're in the face. And usually a lot of it comes back, but the effects of it usually linger for a couple days or so at least. And if you've ever had any type of kidney issues, and, you know, to where they're affected that way, it's really uncomfortable. It really makes you're really not in the good, you know, nauseous feelings and things of that nature. So Danielle Taylor is 1-1 in the UFC. Believe she did fight on the show. Nope, she did not fight on the show. That's my mistake. You get some people mixed up. Being she is 1-1 in the UFC, she did fight a Korean young girl there, and she won that fight by split decision. I'm not going to try to pronounce that name right now, but someday I will. I promise y'all. But to move on, we digress. I would really love to be able to pick Danielle Taylor in this fight, but the reach advantage, unfortunately, might be too much for her. Although, you know, I mean, you're talking Jessica Penny, who has fought. I mean, she did lose to, you know, Joanna Champion, the 115-pound strawweight champ, Joanna Jurcic. I'm sorry, Joanna Jędrzejczyk. You say that? Don't doubt me, people. Don't doubt me. Just hit that subscribe, hit that like, comment, man. Come on, tell me. Let's talk about these fights. Comment now. Stay tuned for Saturday night, my review of these fights. All of them come out quick. You know, I'm not going to sit there. I know y'all have really, really bad attention spans, so that's why I try not to make these videos too long. You know, like Joe Rogan's podcast is 3 hours. I mean, that's a long time. It's a very long time. How do you sit out? I don't get it, but I digress. Let's move on. She also lost. Jessica Penny also lost to Jessica Andre. She's on a 2-fight losing streak, but she does have a win for Randa Markos in the UFC. So she is 1-2. I'm sure she's going to try and get her record back up to 2-2 and jump back up into that hunt, man, and try and it's basically obviously what it's all about. You don't fight to lose. You don't play anything. This isn't playing. You don't do anything to lose. If you do, I mean, in my opinion, you shouldn't do it. But hey, let's have fun. That's all bull to me. I would really, like I said, like to be able to pick Danielle Taylor in this fight. But I do know that Jessica Penny's potential. Has seen her fight several times. Seen a lot of her Invicta fights. And she you know, I was actually surprised that she, how she went down against Jessica Andre. But I'm looking at it, and I'm looking at this, and I'm seeing that she's been TKO'd her last two fights, you know, and, you know, it's going to be close to a year off. She's coming back. She got TKO'd there by Andrade in June of last year. So, you know, it's not like, she's coming back in 3 or 4 months. It's definitely a little bit of time. I always think if you're going to get knocked out, and I don't know how brutally knocked out she was. I know it was pretty bad. It says TKO here, but you should definitely take at least, you know, 6 months away at least from doing anything before you even think about taking any type of training where you're going to get hit in the head. I mean, let that stuff heal even before you start overtraining your body and putting yourself through, you know, crazy stress. And, you know, it's, I'm not saying don't exercise, you know, you don't ever want to do that. You don't want to be like some people I know, but, you know, it's always good to do something and try to keep it going. You got to keep it moving, you know, just like we're doing here with this podcast. So we're going to go with Jessica Penny here, man. I don't like picking a lot of times here with my heart, but I do like her, man. I like her a lot. She's a great fighter. I've seen a lot of her interviews. I like, and you know, I like her skills. She's in a little bit of a tough route right now, and it's hard. You know, I don't want to see anything happen to any of these. You don't want to see anybody lose sometimes, but unfortunately, it does happen. You know, but we got two more fights to go. And two more fights to go. And I'm going to jump out of order to mess y'all up. Now, the first fight we're going to talk about is a 125-pound fight. That's Brandon Moreno against Dustin Ortiz. This should be a very... Actually, I did talk about this yesterday, but if you missed the podcast, I'm going to talk about it again. So I think this is going to be a very interesting fight. Moreno is very young. He's very green. But he's already had a big win. He had a big win over Lewis Smolka, where he choked him out and really surprised him and surprised me. You know, because Smolka's a tough cat. Just fought this past weekend. He did not win, but you know, he definitely always gives you a rough time, and he can beat a lot of people. So I'm looking at this, and Dustin Ortiz hasn't been too impressive in his last few fights, man. This could really propel Moreno up. So you didn't catch yesterday's podcast, I picked Moreno in this upcoming fight there tomorrow night on FS2. If you don't get FS2, download the Fox Sports app. You can get it that way. Check your local provider. You got it? All right. Now, last fight is Scott Holtzman. Scott Holtzman, who was another Team Alpha Male product, who did lose his last fight there, and that was back in December. So he's going to definitely want to try and bounce back. He is a wrestler. You know, he's going up against Michael McBride, who, you know, a pretty heralded kid, was making his UFC debut and fought Nick Lentz, and that was back in September. And that was actually a pretty exciting fight, and then he was doing a pretty good job against Lentz, and Lentz actually came back and won that fight from TKO, which you don't see that happen very often from Nick Lentz. So if you're wondering what I'm talking about what happened very often with Nick Lentz, it's a couple of things. It's winning and winning by knockout. I move on. But I kind of like to see Michael McBride in this fight. But the hot sauce, like I said, the Team Alpha Male product. Or I'm sorry, MMA Lab. I accept Team Alpha Male. He's MMA Lab. I don't know why I thought he was Team Alpha Male. You guys know what to do. Call me a goon in the comments, a jamoke, you know. Keep it clean. Be nice. Hit that thumbs up. It turns blue. You know what you do. If you're not liking the video, don't dislike it. Just hit the thumbs up and turn your tablet upside down for a second. It gives you the same effect. Trust me. But he lost to Josh Emmett. Scott Holtzman lost to Josh Emmett in his last fight in the Watterson-Van Zandt fight. You know, these fights are definitely, you know, you're going to get some decisions. You'll get some finishes on these undercards, you know. If you're a big, really big fight fan like I am, and you watch all these fights, you know, they're definitely worth it. And it's a lot of fun to watch a lot of these fights, so, especially on the undercard, because they're fighting for their lives, especially the Barbarino Joe Proctor, man. Those guys are definitely going to be fighting for their UFC careers at this point. I think either one loses it right now. You know, Proctor being out as long as he was, and anybody loses, out of those two guys loses at this point, they're probably going to be looking at a pink slip, which isn't a fun thing. I mean, you say a pink slip. Is anybody, I mean, maybe you do. I don't know. I don't know if I've ever gotten a pink slip. I've always been told to just get the hell out of here as fast as possible. But we're going to start wrapping it up soon. We are going to get ready for the Music City Showdown. That's right. UFC Fight Night 108 on Fox Sports 1 tomorrow night. Cub Swanson against Artam. I am Conor McGregor's training partner, Lobov. And I can say that because, I mean, I don't know him. I probably would never run into him or meet him, and I don't really think that's a bad thing. I don't necessarily, you know, he no doubt would probably kick my ass, even though I do outweigh him. But what does that matter, you know? If the weight meant anything, then if weight meant anything, then that would mean that, you know, Floyd Mayweather would lose to Conor McGregor, according to Skip Bayless. But, you know, we're all not that stupid to believe that, but I guess Skip Bayless is, because he's I don't even want to say what he is, because I haven't sworn on the video, and I'm not going to start now. But I really appreciate everybody tuning in. Like I guess we're going to start wrapping it up, trying not to make it too long, and we only had a few fights to talk about and a few things. Please stay tuned into the channel for more UFC and MMA content. I am going to do and get a little more in-depth about the Bellator pay-per-view that's coming up in June. Give you more in-depth of my feelings and why I don't think the main event is going to happen. Sorry, Chael. Chael will be fighting somebody, but it's not going to be Vanderlei. That's number two. That's twice that I said that. You know, when are we going to see CM Punk? When are we going to see CM Punk again? We're going to try and find that out. We're going to see if we can get some inside information, some scoop on where CM Punk is. What he was just on Chicago Live, so in his home city there, Chicago, talking about legalizing cannabis. So not that he smokes it, he's straight edge, we all know. But this is the Objective Perspective, episode 4, part 2. 203 Fight Network here on YouTube.com exclusively. Stay tuned for more content. I got it all coming up, and I really appreciate y'all tuning in. If you made this far, hit that thumbs up for yourself, not even for me, because you deserve it. Thank you so much, people. I'm Mark G. Catch the fights. Catch the fights tonight at 10 o'clock on FS1. Thank you so much. Peace.